Thank you, Winston. I hope I am audible to everyone. Good morning and good evening, according to what time zone you are in. In today's discussion, we'll be discussing on Wi-Fi design flow. We will talk about the required libraries or the minimum set of libraries for getting started with Wi-Fi. So today's agenda for discussion will be, first we'll be talking on the different software architecture such as Embed, AFR and AnyCloud. We will talk on AnyCloud Wi-Fi libraries and AnyCloud stack. We will see the use of Library Manager to add Wi-Fi libraries to an empty PSOC 6 project, followed by a set of middleware libraries. We will then discuss on the WWD and WHD, followed with a demo of TCP client application. At the end, we'll be answering your queries. Feel free to ask questions in the chat window during the presentation. So we will be discussing on three software architecture, AnyCloud, Embed, and AFR. And we will see how the components in the architecture changes, but the underlying architecture remains the same. The diagram you can see is the AnyCloud architecture. So the first question is, what is AnyCloud? As the name suggests, AnyCloud is a solution built for customers with their own cloud backend, whether hosted on AWS, Google, Azure, AnyCloud, or any other cloud infrastructure. It is flexible and does not tie you to a specific cloud management solution. So basically, your device can now connect to any cloud of your choice. In this diagram, the blocks represented by the yellow color or the light orangish ones are the wireless libraries, and the ones with green are the PSOC 6 libraries. We will here focus mainly on the wireless libraries and that is towards the left. Okay, now consider that you want to develop an IoT application. You want to get started with Wi-Fi. So what are libraries you will be needing in that case? Okay, so let's figure that out one by one. First of all, you will require a driver or a set of APIs to talk to your Wi-Fi radio. WHD, that is Wi-Fi host driver, will serve this purpose for you. Next, you want a network stack that could implement TCP/IP protocol such as LWIP. You also want your application to be secure. You can use Embed TLS library to build secure applications. You can also use AnyCloud Secure Sockets library for the same purpose with an additional advantage. It will abstract away a lot of complexity offered by the Embed TLS library. You can schedule and manage the tasks in your application via FreeRTOS. Your application will also require Wi-Fi middleware libraries such as WCM that provides a set of APIs to establish Wi-Fi connection. And for the exchange of messages and data, you can use an application layer protocol such as MQTT. Apart from these, you can use Infineon's Low Power Assist LPL library to configure your device for low power operations, and Bluetooth Wicked APIs for Bluetooth low energy functionality as well. We will talk on secure sockets and WCM in our further slides. So now let's change the platform to AFR, that is Amazon FreeRTOS. WHD remains the same in this case. LHIP here changes to FreeRTOS plus TCP for TCP/IP implementation. You can see that FreeRTOS secure sockets take the place of embedded TLS for security implementation, and the FreeRTOS TLS is a wrapper around this secure sockets library to abstract away the cryptographic implementation, which is similar to any cloud secure sockets. The RTOS remains the same. Wi-Fi management library establishes Wi-Fi connections instead of WCM, and you can choose the required application layer protocol such as the given options. Now let's change the platform to Embed. Again, WHT remains the same. Socket class implements TCP/IP and security in case of Embed. Embed OS takes the place of FreeRTOS. To establish Wi-Fi connection, Embed uses connectivity utilities library with your choice of specific application layer protocol. So you can see that if you want to get started with Wi-Fi connectivity with a PSoC 6 device, you have the flexibility to choose between these three platforms. So the names of the libraries change, but the underneath architecture remains the same. Moving on to AnyCloud Stack. So this figure is a different representation of what we have seen before. Here you can see that there is a HAL layer that interacts with the hardware device at a general or an abstract level. Then there is a Wi-Fi host driver layer that provides a set of APIs to interact with Infineon's WLAN chips. There is a network stack that implements TCP/IP protocol. There is a transport layer security, which is a security protocol. We can use a security library such as Embed TLS to implement it. There is Wi-Fi middleware core library that bundles all the core components required for the Wi-Fi connectivity. It includes secure sockets and the porting layer. The connection manager library is there for establishing Wi-Fi connections and the required RTOS. The application sits on top of all these. So the ones in the green block are the third-party libraries. The ones in the blue are Infineon's AnyCloud library. So, and the ones in the gray are the host MCU HAL. So here you can see the application can talk to WHT in many ways. One way is to include Wi-Fi middleware core and WCM to interact with WHT. If you don't want to use the default port layer of middleware core, you can use the network stack and TLS library of your choice with WCM. So as said before, secure sockets lets you build secure applications and takes away a lot of complexity of Embed TLS. But the application can still use the APIs of Embed TLS and network stack directly. The application can also talk to the Wi-Fi host driver directly. So such flexibility is offered by the AnyCloud stack to the application. The LWIP, Embed TLS, and FreeRTOS are all pulled from their respective Git repos, but the RTOS network stack and the security libraries can be substituted with alternatives in any combination. Wi-Fi middleware libraries. So as we have discussed before, we need some middleware libraries to get started with Wi-Fi. The first question again is, what are these libraries? And the next question is, where to select the libraries from? So here is the snapshot of the library manager window that shows a list of Wi-Fi middleware libraries such as LPA, MQTT, OTA, LWIP, Embed TLS, and other middleware libraries of Wi-Fi. So You can see that how this window looks like. I'll show you the library manager window. Only can you show the library manager ID? So this is the library manager ID in Modis Toolbox. You can see in the library section, there are a host of libraries, and in the end, you can see there are Wi-Fi middleware libraries, and these options are mentioned here. So basically, in the library section, this library manager lets you select the libraries that you need according to the application requirement. For example, you can import the Wi-Fi host driver and the LVIP and embed TLS if you want your network stack implementation and TLS implementation in your application. You can go with some other combinations such as WHT, WCM, and MQTT. So it all depends on your choice. If you want to get started with any cloud solution, you can just import the WCM library. This one library alone can be added to an empty PSOC 6 project to get started with Wi-Fi, because it includes the Wi-Fi middleware library by default, and the secure sockets is a part of this Wi-Fi middleware core library. So the documentation is also available in Modis Toolbox of all these libraries that you need in your application. So let's see what are the steps involved if you add Wi-Fi Connection Manager library, or if you import Wi-Fi Connection Manager library to an empty PSOC 6 project in your application. So let's head back to the presentation. Only can you switch to presentation? So if you want to add Wi-Fi to an existing PSOC 6 project, the first step is to ensure that the project is using FreeRTOS. You basically schedule your tasks, whatever task you'll be including in your application. Then you add WCM from the library manager, because all the important libraries that you'll be needing in your application will be included in WCM, such as middleware core and the secure sockets library. This will add all or download all necessary libraries in your application. Now you have to make some changes to the makefile as mentioned below. You need to add components such as FreeRTOS, LVIP, embed TLS. You need to configure some embed TLS flags and the required defines. After making these makefile changes, your code should now compile and your application can now build successfully. So you see that how you can get started with a basic Wi-Fi application by just adding the one library that is WCM to an existing PSOC 6 project. So now let's get started with our first library, that is Wi-Fi middleware core library. So if you are developing an IoT application or an IoT solution, we usually require a bunch of third-party libraries. For example, you will be needing LVIP or NetX for implementing the network stack. You will be requiring embed TLS for implementing security and a plethora of other libraries. So after figuring out what all libraries you need, you have to also import these libraries separately. What if you are given a solution, a single core component that would constitute all these libraries required for your application? So the answer is Wi-Fi middleware core library. Instead of doing the tedious work of adding these libraries separately, you just need to add the middleware core library. It's a bundle of all the core components required by you to develop a basic TCP application or getting the Wi-Fi development done. So let's see Let's see what are the core components included in this middleware core library. So if you can see the .gif files under the devs folder mentioned inside this red box, these are the core components included by this library. So let's have a look on these. First is the abstraction RTOS that makes the application independent of the underneath RTOS. It provides services like threads, semaphores, mutexes, etc. Next is clip support library. It provides all the necessary hooks to make your C library function, such as malloc and free thread, safe. Next comes the connectivity utilities library. It's a collection of general purpose middleware utilities, such as parsing a JSON or logging, etc. You have next three as open source libraries, such as FreeRTOS. That's the FreeRTOS kernel, which is based on publicly available FreeRTOS. The LVIC for implementing a lightweight open source TCP/IP stack, and embed TLS for implementing security. Next is an interesting library that is Secure Sockets, that abstracts away the underlying network, the complexities offered by the underlying network stack and the security library. We'll see this library in our further slides. And the Wi-Fi host driver that provides a set of APIs to interact with Cypress WLAN chips. This WHD will be also covered in detail in further slides of our presentation. So you can see that this library adds LVIP, embed TLS, FreeRTOS, and all these components as dependencies. It bundles these libraries as .lib files, and all these libraries are hosted on Cypress GitHub repository, except the open source libraries such as embed TLS and LVIP. You need not require to download this middleware core library separately in Modus. The Wi-Fi code examples in Modus download this library automatically for you. What else? It also adds the glue between LVIP and WHD, basically a connection layer, as LVIP makes use of WHD APIs as well to send and receive data. Coming on to our next library, that is Wi-Fi Connection Manager Library. So we need a library that should manage Wi-Fi connection, that should provide you with APIs to scan the available access points, should filter out those access points according to the provided parameters. Okay, you should have APIs to join an access point. For example, you want a particular API to basically have an access point with this particular SSID name. So you need APIs for that. Similarly, you need APIs for connection and disconnection for a particular access point. So this library provides APIs for Wi-Fi scan and connection management. In addition to this, during a Wi-Fi connection and disconnection, there are so many events happening in the background. The application should know these events. There should be a mechanism for the applications to know about those events. So this library provides the applications to basically register for those events, such as your access point got connected, your access point got disconnected, or your IP address has been changed. This library also provides the feature to reconnect with an API if a connection loss happens, or somewhere some problem comes that your API gets out of range. So if a connection loss happens or API gets out of range, you have the feature to basically reconnect with your API. And apart from these features, this library also implements WPS, that is Wi-Fi protected setup, for easy and secure establishment of a wireless network. So you can see in the diagram here that you have Wi-Fi connection manager library that sits besides the Wi-Fi app, that sits below the Wi-Fi application. Your application can interface with the WCM library, and it can directly talk to Wi-Fi host driver as well. If you want to use LBIP TLS library from public repo or LBIP library from the LBIP stack, you can also interface these with the Wi-Fi connection manager. And that is some other way of basically interacting with Wi-Fi host driver. This Wi-Fi connection manager library includes the middleware code library by default that we discussed previously. And as we know that secure sockets is a part of middleware code library, that's why addition of only this library, WCM, can make your basic application getting started with a piece of SIPS device. So we know now that this basically sits above RiaTOS, LVIP, and MBIT TLS, as you can see in the architecture block diagram. This library also helps to reduce code when integrating various app-level protocol libraries such as MQTT. We can see two example APIs here of WCM. Okay, so one is CY underscore WCM underscore edit that basically initializes your Wi-Fi connection manager library. And other is the register underscore event underscore callback, which basically registers an event callback to monitor the connection and IP address change events. Now, this is an interesting library that is secure sockets. So if you are trying to develop a networking application, you need to be clear with the underlying network and security stack thoroughly. If you are trying to develop a secure connection or a non-secure connection, you have to invoke completely different set of APIs. Specifically with security stacks like MBIT TLS, you will be scratching your head to figure out n number of APIs just to execute one task. So consider an example of a TLS handshake or a secure connection. You can see in these MBIT TLS APIs for the TLS handshake, you will be invoking 17 APIs of MBIT TLS just to establish a TLS handshake. If you go through these 17 APIs, many of them are not known to us. And many of them are used internally within MBIT TLS, and it will be hard for the typical application developer to understand. So what does Secure Sockets library provide? Instead of understanding all these complex APIs and figuring out which all to call for getting a TLS handshake done, you just need to invoke this one API, that is CY underscore TLS underscore connect. You just need to provide two arguments, that is context handle and the endpoint type, for the TLS handshake to be done. Similarly, if you consider the underlying network stacks, for example, LVIP. So in this LVIP network stack, if you want to read your received data, your application need to invoke a particular API that is known as NetCon Receive API. Now, this API returns a chain of network buffers, and a particular application developer should know how to handle this network buffer to be able to read the received data. So with a network abstraction API that Secure Sockets provide, the logic to read the chain of buffers is bundled inside abstraction. And it just simplifies the efforts of a particular application developer. So in simple words, Secure Sockets is a wrapper around the LVIP and the MBIT TLS library. What does it do? It provides the abstraction APIs for the underlying network and security library. So it's kind of an abstraction layer that sits on top of LVIP and MBIT TLS. So you don't need to deal with LVIP and MBIT TLS directly. In case of any cloud solution, you have the default network stack as LVIP and the security library as MBIT TLS. And in future, these components can be seamlessly switched to use some other network stack such as ThreadX or NetX or even a different security stack. This library also provides simple socket-like API to use. So if you're familiar with creating sockets or connecting to the server side or finding sockets, etc., this library will be easy to handle for you. And it also supports both client and server modes. So let's compare two files of TCP client application. And there we can see that how one file being an older version and the one with the AnyCloud solution, you will see the changes that that has been brought up by with AnyCloud solution. So let's go through that. So this is a main.c file that was before the AnyCloud solution was launched. So if you can see here, you need to include various header files of the LVIP network stack. You need to include other header files of embed TLS libraries. Okay, and if you see the other main.c file that AnyCloud offers, you only need to include a secure socket header files, which is an abstraction provided for removing the complexities offered by LVIP and embed TLS, and a connection manager library for getting your Wi-Fi connection established. So consider an a basic function here, such as TCP client task. Okay. So here you can see that you need to initialize or define these embed TLS structures. You need to initialize the embed TLS library and various other libraries to basically getting started and establishing a TCP server connection. You have to add an interface to LVIP as well. But if you compare this with the secure TCP client application, you're just getting you start with connecting to a Wi-Fi access point. You just initialize a socket address structure here, providing the IP address and TCP port number, and you initialize the socket init library that basically will provide you with all those features that are there in this main.c file. So if you see here, there are no embed TLS structures getting initialized or all the complexities which is getting involved in LVIP and embed TLS. So the code basically becomes somewhat readable and easy to getting started with Wi-Fi, and it basically abstracts away a lot of complexity, a lot of thinking process that you need to invoke so many APIs, you need to invoke various other things to basically getting started with it. So this you can basically go through these C files to understand what is this AnyCloud solution offering to you. So now I'll be handing over to Murli, which will talk on WHD and WWD drivers in detail. Handing over you to Murli.
Hello everyone. Before I start talking about what Wi-Fi drivers are, I thought that for the sake of the completeness of the topic, I'll just talk a few words about what software drivers are. Just give me a second. So what are drivers? Drivers are nothing but the software which allows multiple hardware to interact. This may be allowing a keyboard to interact with the CPU of a computer, an audio driver, a Wi-Fi driver. It may be of many types. Even a Bluetooth, or it may be of multiple types. So what is a Wi-Fi driver? A Wi-Fi driver is nothing but the software which allows the CPU or the OS to interact with the network card or the Wi-Fi card in case of a personal computer, or you know, devices which are capable of processing heavy applications. Now, coming to an embedded system, what is a Wi-Fi driver? It is nothing but the software which allows the host processor to interact with the WLAN chip. In case of Infineon, which was formerly Cypress, this was known as WWD, which was coming with Wicked. Now it's having an improved version of called WHD. So before I talk about the latest version, the Wicked host driver, let me just talk a few words about what WWD is or was. The Wicked Wi-Fi driver, as I said, was used to interact with the host processor and the WLAN chip. So how was this achieved? Say, for example, I wanted to connect my device to an access point. What I used to do is, I used to do a Wicked network up. Basically, this was an API in Wicked, which I used to connect to an AP. So what did this API do? It used to take up various parameters, say whether it is using a static server or a DHCP server, the SSID, the password, the security, and much more parameters, and used to pass this through an abstraction layer, which would put it in a required format so that the driver would understand. Essentially, finally, what this driver used to do, send this to the WLAN chip and achieve the required functionality. But what was the issue with Wicked? The Wicked Wi-Fi driver. The major thing was the Wicked Wi-Fi driver was, hardly intertwined with Wicked. What I mean by this is, say, as you could see here, for the WWD or the WLAN host driver to work, it needs multiple components, say a network buffer, a network stack, an RTOS, resources, and multiple other things. So all these things were placed in multiple different folders, and it became quite difficult to port. Suppose if I didn't want to use something which is readily available in Wicked, say a host processor which wasn't there in Wicked, porting it to my required host processor was quite, tedious and troublesome. And hence, an improved version of Wicked, that is WHD, was designed. So as before, WHDs again used to interact with our WLAN chips. One advantage is this thing is hosted publicly on our GitHub repo. So what essentially happens is, whenever an update is pushed to the WHD repo on GitHub, you can continuously stay updated to the latest release by us. So, and which this made it a lot more portable. Now, what does this statement modular with any cloud mean? As you saw before, the Wi-Fi, the library manager adds the libraries to each and every project. So what essentially used to happen is, say you have a workspace and are working with multiple projects, say A, B, C, and D. Each of those projects had their own copy of WHD. So if you wanted to say meddle with the WHD and see, say something what this does or what that does, you need not worry about it affecting all the other projects. So, and if something happened, it used to only affect that project, and you could easily recover that project, and not much time would be lost in recovering everything other things also, which wasn't the case in Wicked. Say if you messed up the WWD, everything was messed up. Now coming to how this WHD is structured. Basically, the include folder under WHD contains all the different APIs that come as part of the Wi-Fi host driver. The source contains all the source code, that is the .c files that come as part of the Wi-Fi host driver. And then the resources folder contains the APIs that are needed to implement the resource critical information, say the NVRAM file, the CLM blob file, and the binary file, which are very essential for the WHD to function. Now, before going into understanding about the porting functions involved with WHD, let us understand how the WHD was actually designed. If you could see here, the WHD contains multiple blocks, say a firmware download module, a chip logging module, control, event, data, and multiple layers along with the HAL that is required to port. So what this essentially did is, separating out each and every module, helped us to debug much more easier. Say if you found some error in the data module, then singly pointing the error to that became a lot more easier when compared to the previous version, that is WWD. So Now, let us go on understanding the different modules that are present in WHD. First, the firmware download and the WLAN chip logging module. So, what does this module do? This module has access of the bus interface at which you will be using, that may be either SDIO or SPI independently, so that it can download the resource critical data onto your WLAN device. This is the NVRAM, the CLM blob, the binary file. That is the firmware. The CLM blob is the file which contains the regulatory information with respect to multiple other countries. The NVRAM file is the file which contains parameters related to your board, say the antenna gain, or which country the chip needs to initialize to. So once these three modules are, say three files are completely downloaded, the chip was in a state to start running. Now, there's one more module called the chip logging module here. So what this does, say whenever you want to get the logs from a chip, this is the module to go to, whether it may be because of a firmware trap or whether you want to check whether the chip is functioning properly, whatever it may be. This was the module to go to. Now, coming to the control module. This module is responsible for sending out all types of command functions. Say it may be a join, it may be a scan, and it may be anything basically. And it uses something which is known as IO controls. So that is IOCTL, IOCTL. So what this essentially does is, whenever a control information or a control packet is sent out, it wraps it with the required format from the control data layer, which I'll talk about in a few moments, and passes it on to the further layers for further processing. Now, coming to the data module. This is responsible for sending out any sort of data packets. This may be a TCP packet, a UDP packet, an MQTT, HTTP. It may be anything basically. All sorts of data packets are sent through this data module. Again, this gets added with one more header known as the BDC, which again I'll talk about in a few moments. And then comes the event module. Any sort of events that needs to be registered. Say, for example, I have a TCP client running on my device, and I say I have a TCP server running on my PC. Suppose I want my client to respond and send data whenever the server starts accepting data. That will be basically, you know, designed to trigger it like an event. So that event is registered here. It may be a scan event also, and any number of possibilities are there basically. So now comes this protocol layer. So any sort of packet, it may be a control or a data packet, needs to pass through this protocol layer. And it is required whether you are using SDIO or SPI. And as you could see here, there are two types of headers which get added in the CDC and the PDC layer. So what are they? Coming to the CDC layer. The CDC layer is the control. Whenever the control module needs to send messages, this layer adds certain 16 bytes of control data headers, so that the WLAN chip will be in a position to identify that this packet is a control packet and achieve the required functionality. The structure of this is as you could see here. Okay, this is available when you download the WHD library. The first four bytes are the command values, which the IOCTL commands that I talked about before take. Next is the buffer length, the flags, and the status code. That is whether the function was successful or not, multiple any other control code that is needed. Then comes the PDC layer. This module is responsible for sending out, data modules after heading the required data headers to them. This is again 4 bytes in size, and the structure is as you could see here. It adds flags, decides the priority of that flag, and the data offset, that is any offset from the end of the BDC header to the packet data. Now comes the bus layer. This layer is basically responsible for handling all types of protocols. It may be SDIO or SPI. That is the overall this layer that you see. And for whenever you're using SDIO or SPI, a custom protocol which is known as HTTPM, HTTPCM, a header, if I may use the word, is added to send out the data packets. So what is this HTTPCM and what is it responsible for? This HTTPCM takes care of the adding the sequence number to the WLAN packets. Say, suppose there are 100 packets. This is the module that adds the required, say, you are the first packet, you are the second packet, you are the third packet, and so on. And is also responsible for the flow control. Again, all these things come at a cost of an additional 10 bytes of header. How this is defined, it is visible in this structure. It uses the prep tag, the sequence, channels, next length, flow control, bus, data crate. If you could see here, this says there's something called crate from WLAN chip, because this uses some sort of a crate mechanism, which I'll again explain in a few slides. Then come the packet queue. So what is this packet queue responsible for? Say, whenever a data is being sent, after it processes the bus layer, it comes to the packet queue. What this packet queue essentially does is, queues up all the data in a form of a linked list. And again, it is responsible to check, whenever a data is also received, it further receives it and sends to the upper layers for further processing. And how this interacts and achieves interacts with the HTTPCM and achieves the required functionality, I'll talk about it. Then finally come the WHT bus interface and the HAL or the SPI HAL interface. So what does this do? This WHT bus interface gives bus independent access. What I mean by that, it can, your host processor can be either SDIO or an SPI interface. And you don't need to worry about the how it would affect the upper layers, because the APIs would remain the same across both SDIO and SPI. And here, if you could see here, it is mentioned as CYHAL-SDIO and CYHAL-SPI. This is just a representation, and there is no hard and fast rule saying that this needs to be a Cypress model. It may be any host processor from any vendor. And it interacts with the respective host controller hardware, and it's external to the WHT. Now coming to how the flow control is achieved using HTTPCM and the packet queue. As I said before, the packet queue, queues up the data that is being sent to it in the form of a linked list, which is quite apparent from this flow diagram. Now, how is this further sent to the WLAN chip? If you could see here, the HTTPCM flow control ensures that the host processor or the on which the WHT is implemented waits for credits that is being that will be received from the WLAN chip. So what are these credits? These credits are nothing but the a way of the WLAN chip saying that, say, I am ready to receive 10 bytes of data or 20 bytes of data, whatever it may be. Once so many number of credits are received, the HTTPCM layer sends out so many with the help of the packet queue, sends out so many number of packets, 1, 2, 3, 4 up to whatever the number that is read, and based on the remaining memory and of the WLAN chip, it again sends out that you can send so many more packets, and again this process continues till no more packets are available to be sent, or no more data is available to, or the memory is empty here on the WLAN chip. Now, after knowing how the WHT is designed, what the WHT is, we can learn about how to port the WHT. As you could see here, the WHT, the main core of the WHT, that is the ones which you get when you download the library file from GitHub, are the ones highlighted in black. The boxes highlighted in red are the ones that you need to port, and the ones in blue are the ones which go and sit in that block. So again, the CY here is just as representation, and there's no hard and first rule saying that it needs to be what Cypress offers. Now, the first thing that you need to put, the RTOS API. This RTOS, what all needs to be ported here? Any RTOS functionality. It may be a thread, it may be a semaphore, it may be a mutex, it may be any related thread function needs to be ensured that it is ported here. Then comes the HAL resource API. So what does this do? This makes use of, as I said before, it makes use of the HAL APIs which would be ported, and is responsible, this block is responsible for downloading the Wi-Fi firmware, the NVRAM, the CLM blob, which are quite critical for the functioning of the Wi-Fi chip onto the chip. Then comes the buffer interface. So as I said before, the packet queue, queues of the data that is being sent to it, that is achieved by this buffer interface porting that will be done. Again, there's no hard and fast rule that saying that this needs to be one single thing. It may be pbuf if you are using LBIP, it may be NX packet pool if you are using NetX, it may be anything based on the network stack that is being used. The advantage of this is, since there is no hard and fast rule that this needs to be this itself, it allows the WHT to and the host processor to operate in an abstract way. Then comes the network interface. Again, this is responsible for sending out and receiving all types of Ethernet data. It may be TCP/IP data packets or any other packets. And as you could see here, this needs to be ported using LWIP or NetX or any other network stack that is being used. Then last but not the least comes the HAL, the layer that needs to be ported, that is the hardware abstraction layer. The WHT uses the following functions to have host to access the host bus controller for both, either it may be either SDIO or SPI, and these functions needs to be replaced appropriately to ensure that the host processor under question is communicating properly with our WLAN chip and the required functionality is achieved. So this was all that I had to talk about the porting stuff. Now, if I may, I have a demo to show. Okay. I have ported the example to VS Code, which is again an advantage of using any cloud. Its VS Code is a lot more easier, easier to use. Now, what have I done here? I'm using a PSoC 6 protokit using the 4343 Wi-Fi chip. What essentially is done in this demo is, I have initialized the board as a TCP client. I am using the CAPSense to read the data. That is, this board has a two CAPSense button and a CAPSense slider. I'll read the data appropriately, and on the push of the button, it will decide that whether this data needs to be sent or data transmission needs to be stopped. So how have I done this? Basically, what is done is, first I have created three queues. One, so that the data, once it is being read from the CAPSense, can be pushed and the data can be read before being transmitted. Then I create three tasks, one for the TCP, one for the CAPSense, and one for the LED. And the scheduler start. So what has gone into this functions? First, I open the declaration of this, and the function is defined in the another file called ledtask.c. Here, what essentially happens is, based on the button that is pushed, it either starts the LED or turns off the LED or initializes the update PWM so that the brightness can be varied along with the variation of the CAPSense. Now, coming to the main part, that is the TCP client task. So what have I done here? Here, what is essentially done is, I initialize the socket, as Aditi said before. I have defined the TCP IP address, that server IP address, that is the one on my laptop, then the version of IP packet, and the TCP server port, which is I'm using as 5007. Then I connect to the Wi-Fi AP. As you could see, I am making use of the WCM library. The interface is defined. All I need to do is do the CYWCM Wi-Fi init, copy the required credential parameters, and do a CYWCM connect AP, and your device is connected to the AP, and it's ready to go. Then what is further? Then the socket is initialized, CY socket init, no other function. And then finally, I connect to the TCP server. So what is done here? A CY socket connect function is written. I register callbacks. Say, as I said before, the event module registering the callback is defined here. I have a TCP client receive handler so that whenever the server sends out some data, this is in a position to receive that data. And whenever TCP disconnection occurs, again, there's another callback responsible for handling that disconnection. So what does this client receiver handler do? That is, whenever the server is ready to receive the data, what am I doing here? So what essentially I'm doing here is, once it comes, the callback is received, I read the data that is pushed to the queue during the capsense function. And based on whether the data can be sent or not, I'm sending this data to the TCP server. So let's go to the demo now. Okay, on my server side, that is on my PC, I have a Python script which is running here. Now let me just start the demo. If you could see here on the right side of my screen, I reset the board. The Wi-Fi connection manager is initialized. It's trying to connect to the AP. This is the AP that I'm using. An IP address was assigned to it, and it connected to a TCP server. That is, if you could see here, it is incoming connection accepted on 192.168.29.57. So now, if I press this button, LED is on. It says the data from TCP client, CapSense data, will be sent. Now if I scroll this, if you could see here, the data is being received. There is a small lag that is happening because I'm using this additional application, which is allowing me to screen mirror whatever I see on my phone on the laptop. But if this is turned off, every single data that you could see here would be transmitted here. I will also show that also. Now I turn off the transmission, and if I scroll this thing, it says that data is not being sent, that please enable in CapSense. I turn it on again, I transmit, and the corresponding data is received. So now I'll just disconnect this. And if you could see now, every other data is transmitted as it is read from the CapSense. That could be it for my presentation. Are there any questions?
Hi, Murali. Device configurator tab of the project.
Do you want to see the library manager?
Not that. The device configuration. Did you do any configuration in the Wi-Fi module side?
Yes, I just defined the SSID, the password, that's it, nothing else.
So you don't have to set anything in the device configurator. Everything is can be done from...
Yeah, it's actually, see, if you could see here, this is the example. All I did is, once you have this, just, you know, have the SSID, define the password, and, you know, added this example that is... stop send an enum which will allow me to send or receive the data, and that's all. Nothing else I did for the configuration. If you just do a CYBSP in it, it should take care of everything else.
Okay.
We will take another couple of minutes before we close the session.
Only there is a question.
I see the question. Is there some echo? Hello? Yeah, it's better. Yeah. Do you have some information about the memory footprint, minimum ROM, RAM required for Wi-Fi access and the individual add-ons? I don't have the exact numbers of ROM and RAM. Maybe I could, you know, give out this answer when we share the PPT. There's one more question. Is this demo publicly available or is there any documentation? Yes, there are plenty of demos available on the GitHub repo. This example is a bit modified, but again, we can share this.
So we will post this demo in our GitHub community, for example, training page as well. There are example projects on the first three sessions, and we'll add this to session number 4. And that information, we'll send it out at the end of the week with the presentation as well. Okay, Winston, you want to add anything? I think we can close.
Right. let us know. We can cover those numbers.
Yeah, like Winston said, there'll be a feedback form that would come across to everybody. And any further ideas for training sessions with related to Modus Toolbox, please let us know there so that we can take it up in the future. Thank you everyone for joining in, and we'll see you again next month for the next session. And we'll let you know what that session is soon. Thank you.